and hallelujah, you've torn apart, and you have
torn apart the sea, you have buried
through the deep. And hallelujah.
Good morning, good morning. Good to see everybody. If you're in the hallway, we'd like to ask you to come into the sanctuary. If you're joining us online, welcome. We're just going to love Jesus back this morning. Amen? All right.
The victory. Seated for just a moment. You seem a little rowdy this morning. I like it a lot. It's good to see you this morning. If this is your first time being with us, I hope you'll take a moment and fill out one of the visitors' cards in the seat in front of you. You probably won't have time to get it in the offering plate this morning, but you can give it to me on the way out the door, and we're just delighted that you're here. We're excited about baptism at the end of service and just a lot of cool things that are going on this morning, so we're glad you're here to be a part of it. I wanted to, two things, thank those that helped us yesterday with the yard work around. It was, thank you so much to everyone who came out. We especially appreciate the presence of Dave and Vicky's tractor. That was a huge blessing and really changed the game. But there were a whole lot of folks that just did a whole lot of good stuff around here yesterday and over the weekend. Thank you so much to all of you. Thanks again for all of you that were able to be with us last night at Bella Roma. It was the first of the meet and eats that we've been able to have in a while. We had a great time. Food was great, just a great time of fellowship. So thank you to all of you that were there. And if you weren't able to be there, we look forward to you being with us at the next one. I also wanted just to remind you of our Wednesday night Bible study. Great time this past Wednesday. My, what a great time of intercessory prayer. And I want to just encourage you, the meal starts at 6. The lesson starts at 6:45, and we'd love to have you be a part of that with us. Remember the Sunday school at 9:45. They're in the book of Revelation right now, and encourage you to be a part of that study and that class. You will be blessed, I promise. Remember, on May 7th, we've got a drop-in baby shower for Johnny and Kenya and the upcoming little one. Yeah, we're super, super excited about that. It's May 7th. It'll be at 2:30 until a couple of hours. By way of prayer request this morning, I know a couple of things. Please remember Mamaw, Weldon's mom. She is just kind of up and down and all over the place. And just, you know, so just continue to remember her, remember the family. Also, some encouraging news from Doug Cornwell, and we just want to continue to remember him. I know we're just praying for a miracle that God will just move and work in the situation. He begins some treatments and things over the next day, couple of days and weeks, so let's just remember him. I know you got the text out about Charlene Evans and not only the physical need, but also some other situations and things. And then if you would this morning, remember Junior Ruff. You got the text this morning. They had to take him to the hospital last night, transferred him to Redmond, found out that part of the problem is infection in his spine. And so they're trying this morning to take a biopsy and figure out exactly what's going on. Many of you remember that he had the kidney stones and was in the hospital, you know, kind of in and out of hospital just a couple of weeks ago. So just remember the family. Also remember my friend Langer Argueta, and then also remember a special need that was given to me, John Englert. And I know we're continuing to remember Fletch's neighbor, Lois, as well as several other needs. I know Bunt, Julie's brother-in-law. And let's also especially remember Scott's brother, Bobby, Fletch's son, Bobby. Let's just remember him. He's in Bogota, Colombia. And just a real special physical need and otherwise. And God knows, doesn't he? All of you who have loved ones that are on the other side of the world, and sometimes 5 hours away feels like the other side of the world, doesn't it? But you know how hard it is when you're here and they're there and you can't put your hands on them, lay eyes on them. Scott's going to be probably taking a trip to see him soon, and so we're just praying for Scott's safety as he goes down and is able to kind of just intervene and lay eyes on him and have prayer with him and things. So let's just remember them this morning. Do you have unspoken requests this morning? Yeah, I mean, literally, hands all over the building. Yeah. I'm going to ask the ushers, if they would, to go ahead and come on down. And as they come, we're going to just pray. Becky's going to come up in just a moment and talk a little bit about our gratitude and then a little bit of what you saw in the foyer with upcoming outreach for a homeless ministry. So, Father, thank you so much for your goodness and mercy to us. Thank you, Lord, that in this place this morning, we are so hungry and expectant. Lord, we're expectant of your power and presence in our midst, moving and working. And this we know, that you are a good, good Father. And those things that you do in our lives and the way you beckon and draw us, God, you do it out of love. And I'm praying this morning that if there's anyone in this building who feels far away, and maybe they feel a bit isolated, maybe they feel somehow as though they feel so distant and separated from you, but others in their lives, I pray today would be the very day that they would come running home and recognize, Lord, that you've been singing over them all along and you've been in pursuit of them all this time and you have never walked away, you've never left, you've never forsaken. So, Lord, today, may it be a day where people realize, God, your nearness. And I thank you that you are near those that are sick in body. This morning, we specifically call out Junior this morning. And God, we ask you, Lord, right there in the Redmond Hospital, not only to give the doctors insight and wisdom, but Lord, we ask you to just bring healing to bear in his body. You provided the way. And so, Lord, I pray right now that whatever the source of this infection is, that you would just bring healing to his body. And Lord, we just give you praise and honor and glory today for all that you're going to do. As we give with all of our heart, Lord. And may you receive all glory and honor and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers, if you'd receive the tithe and offering.
Okay, well, first of all, I just, Scott had mentioned just how thankful he was about the service on Wednesday, and I've heard that that was just absolutely incredible. And then Jessica said that the little girl in Melanie's room, that she is healed, and she got to go home, praise the Lord. And then I'm just so grateful that we have another baptism today. You know, when the Lord is moving, things happen. And so about the homeless outreach that is out in the foyer, If you would, if you want to give, just take the tag, and there's a dollar amount on there, and if you'll just put that in the tithe envelope with your money, and then the church is just going to go buy all the things. Typically, when we go out, we take about 20, enough for 20 people. We are not getting 20 tents and 20 sleeping bags at this point, so there's only a few of those out there, but everything else we're trying to get 20 of. And then also, I just want to talk to our people that are online watching us. If you want to send in your praise reports, we would love to hear what the Lord is doing in your part of the country, or the world, actually. So if you could email us at cfccartersville@gmail.com, or send it via Messenger on Facebook, CFC Cartersville, or put it in the chat under the service, we will get it. Thank you.
I'm excited this morning. Caleb contacted me earlier in the week and said the Lord had just really put some things on his heart to share for us as an exhortation, a word from the Lord. So I've asked him this morning if he would just share that with us as we prepare to continue worship. And I know you're going to be blessed.
Yes, if he can use me, imagine what he can do with you. Now that we got that out of the way. God gave me a word about 2 weeks ago. He said, you'll meet two types of people. You'll meet those that are about the world, and you'll meet those that are about the word. Told my mom that. She's like, that'll preach. I was like, huh, funny you say that. I got a buddy of mine. We send scripture to each other every day. And I told him that. But then he's like, yeah, man, that's good. Well, then I got a little pickup. I'm like, no, man. And I said, it's more than that. I'm like, that means we got to put on the armor of God. We got to see it out there. And I added more to it. Can't remember exactly what it said. Mom was like, yeah, yeah, what did he say? And I said, nothing. He left me on red. But he's Baptist. It makes sense. Just kidding. So, yeah, it did draw me near to the Word and those about the Word and those about the world, how you know the difference. The armor of God, we have to put on the armor of God as men and women of Christ. Ephesians 6, starting at 11, says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand the evil every day, and having done all to stand. Therefore, having girded your wrist with the truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith, which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. And for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. And that speaks boldly in itself. Snake's part's the hard part. We have, I'm not saying we in general, Christians in general, we have gone to make God's word as though it's soft. And the way he told me, he's like, my word is not candy. It does not need to be sugar-coated. I said what I meant, and I meant what I said. Well, you know, we got it, and I get it. 1 John 4:8, God is love. I get that. But you hear so many people, oh, you get saved. Once you get saved, oh, it's all good. No, it ain't, man. It's been so many times that we forget about in Matthew chapter 7, starting in verse 13, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many ways to go in by it, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way that leads to life. There are few who finds it. I love how ESV puts it, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. So he's telling you that it's not easy at all. And he just put that on me very much so. And he goes back to, he means what he says. Just this, he wouldn't mind this, you know, just like a little drink. Why would you want to take that chance? His word says, no drunkard would be allowed into heaven. That's enough for me. I'm like, I'm not going to risk it. So we need to understand that God's word, yes, it is love. And the reason that he stands firm in it is because he loves us. And it is so easy for us to get caught up in the world. I've done it many, numerous of times, you know. And we also think, well, money. We think money is the fix. Well, if we go back to Matthew 19:24, it's easy for a camel to walk through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And he actually declares it twice. Prior to that, in verse 23, he said, it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Then in 24, he said, again, I say. I know this is tough. It's tough for me. Even tougher to get up here and speak on it. But God also, he put a song on my heart to go in. And if you know, I believe all of y'all will know it. So I just felt called to do this. God put it on me, and I hope it spoke to somebody besides me. Y'all can go ahead and stand back up. We're entering into worship. Like I said, you will more than likely know this song. Well, I thought that number one would surely be me. Oh, I thought I what I wanted to be. Oh, I thought I could build on life's sinking sands, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh, I thought I could do a lot on a mighty big man, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Well, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountain's too high and the valley's too wide. Down on where I learned to stand.
name I'll call. And if I should question him, I'll be less than amen. Because I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding. I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
Amen.
My God, how great thou art.
when Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home with joy shall fill. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. And I just want to speak. Dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name. Overfear and all anxiety.
Every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire. Shout Jesus from the mountains. Jesus in the street. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family. I speak the holy name, Jesus. Oh, 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 shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name.
It may even be spiritual, but you've got a need and you'd like to be prayed for this morning. I want you to come as CB sings that for us one more time. I can't think of a greater declaration. Can you? Your name is life. Over every situation and circumstance and things that vaunts itself against the authority of God and God's power rises, He speaks life. He brings restoration. He brings the dead bones back to life. And He can do that this morning. He wants to do that this morning. We keep referring to Wednesday night, Wednesday night, Wednesday night. I can't even fully put words on Wednesday night. But I know that part of what happened in that room Wednesday night as the Holy Spirit just kind of rushed in was that we were warring and contending over folks who needed to be warred over. We were warring in the heavenlies, if you will. And listen, that may very well be for somebody who's in this room this morning. that we want to come alongside you, and we want to just kind of wave the banner of the glory and the power of God. God's kingdom come, His will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Right here, right now. We talked last week and for the last couple of weeks about signs and wonders, and I can't think of a better moment for that to happen than right now. Can you? Do you believe He's able to demonstrate and manifest signs and wonders? I believe He's longing for His church to lean in and love Him back and reach out our hands and say, just like Peter and John, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. So this morning, we're going to do that. You're here. You want to come join these. We're going to lay hands on these. If many of you would gather behind them, this is absolutely participatory. This isn't just a handful of us laying hands on folks. This is every part of the body mobilizing.
Hey, listen, it's really just this simple this morning. The Lord said, and is saying, try me. Try me. Smallest thing, whatever it is, try me. And it's been a while since you've extended faith toward Christ. With whatever it is, just do it. Comes to your mind, just do it. Try Him. Watch what He does. Try Him. He knows how. Try Him.
The devil's working overtime, but you haven't noticed in everybody. At everybody, he's attacking left and right, and he's working overtime. And this is the place to leave it, right here on this altar, because we got to fight. We got to fight the devil. He is working on everybody's life, and he's interfering with everything in your Christian walk. This is the place to leave it.
Shine through the shadows, your light. just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name is power.
Three quick things I want to share about Jesus. He's not a baby in a manger anymore. He didn't stay in the grave. And he ain't staying in heaven forever. If you've got loved ones, friends, relatives that need to come to the Lord, pray about it. Give it to him and he can take care of it. Thank you.
promises are yes and amen, yeah.
Just tarry in that moment. Sing that as Callan sing that. Sing that over yourself. Just sing that. Declare that. Let it come out of your mouth. Such a simple thing, but Wednesday night it just really, really, really was heavy on my heart that in Acts chapter 2 they tarried. And the word tarry just literally means to stay a little longer than you thought you would in a space, in a place, in a moment. And I want to ask you just one more moment. Just tarry with Him. And as CB sings that and we sing that together, just let that be that the prayer out of your heart. Listen, as I'm saying those words, there are folk in this place that are saying, but Pastor, you don't know what I've been through. You don't know what I've done. You don't know the havoc that I've wreaked, the chaos that I've created. You don't know the estrangement. You don't know the need in my life. You don't know any of that, Pastor. How could I possibly sing that? Listen, this is a declaration about Him. It's not about you. This is a declaration that He's faithful. And I promise you, as you declare His faithfulness, you're going to experience that faithfulness. You're going to experience His presence and power to come alongside you in one moment to transform and change not only you and everything that's going on in you, but also to change the outcomes. Now, He doesn't always change the outcome. Sometimes He says, look, I'm going to give you grace and strength to walk through it. I'm going to give you power to overcome and to go over the mountain. But I'll never walk away from you. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll walk with you through it. So as we sing that one more time, let's just let that be our declaration. I challenge you, out of your mouth to His ear, declare His faithfulness this morning. Sing it. Sing it one more time.
Yeah.
Sing it out loud. Let's fill this room with that declaration this morning. If you don't want to, then I'm not going to make you. I am going to dismiss the children. They're going to go out for a couple of minutes, but they're going to come back for the baptism. That'll be in a handful of minutes. But I want to share with you just for a few minutes and kind of finish the thought that we had going last week where we were talking about what happens on the way to church. Or the alternate title that I gave the message from Acts chapter 3 and 4 was Flowing, Glowing, and Growing in Jerusalem. God's intention for you and I is that we are flowing, that we are glowing, light, salt, and that we are growing in our walk with Him. And so what is it that we do with moments like this? What is it we do with moments like we experienced on Wednesday night? And that's the heart of what this message is about. Acts chapter 2, they tarried, they waited, they were filled. And they would, the scriptures say, continually be filled over and over and over and over. We'll read again, even in the chapters we're in today, that they were filled afresh. They were filled anew. The place was shaken. So it wasn't that it was a one-time deal and they never revisited that. It was that they were going to be filled, baptized to overflowing, and then they were going to walk being filled and overflowing. You keep hearing me use this term being a conduit, and that's what God desires for us, is that we're a conduit, that we allow His Spirit to flow in us and through us. And so that's what He wants for us. What do we do with this reviving that we're experiencing, that we're talking about, that we're in the middle of? What do we do with it? And that's kind of the heart of this message. I don't want to go back and read all of the passage that I read last week, because I read a lengthy one. But I want to just go back to chapter 3, Acts chapter 3, verse 1, for those that weren't here. And I want to just kind of read a snippet of it so that as we get into this today and finish this idea, hopefully it'll make sense. I believe it will. Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. And a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms from those who entered the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked for alms. And fixing his eyes on him with John, Peter said, "Look on us." So he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. And immediately, everybody say immediately. Immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. So he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. And they knew it was he who sat begging alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. They were filled with wonder and amazement at what happened to him. Father, I ask over these next few moments that you would give me the words that you have anointed for this moment. I'm not asking you this morning to anoint the things I want to say, but I'm asking you today to let me open my mouth and speak the things for which you have already anointed and prepared the hearers of this word so that it may rest deep inside our spirits. And Lord, we may at the same moment be comforted and troubled at the very same time. That we be stirred in the inner man, in the inner woman, that we be stirred so that when we leave this place, we recognize and realize that when we experience moments like this, where you brood and hover, where you pour your presence and your spirit so thick and tangibly like this, Lord, what is it that we do with that? How is it that that should not only impact us, but Lord, how is it that it impacts those that we come in contact with? So send us out of this place today, Father, as testimonies, as witnesses of what you can do and will do and want to do. And I thank you for that, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. So for a couple of weeks, we've been talking about revival and what it ought to look like. And we talked last week a little bit about the importance of baptism because we see that again popping up in verse 41. I mentioned to you last week about the importance of signs and wonders, and we don't use those terms very often anymore, and we ought to, because the scripture is replete and full of the fact that God says when his spirit is at work among his people, there will be signs and wonders that follow those that are good enough. Signs and wonders will follow those that are at the top of their class. Signs and wonders will follow those who are number one. No. He said signs and wonders will follow those who believe. Those whose confidence and trust is in Christ and who believe that what he said he would do, which is what Caleb said a moment ago, that what he said he would do, he is willing and ready, not only capable, but longing to do. And we begin to take him at his word. We see those signs and wonders. We made mention of the fact last week that as the early church experiences the presence and power of God, that they lost contact with or they lost their desire for the material things of life. They lost their goals of just amassing more and more and more because they recognized the return of Christ was near. Now listen, I'm not saying you've got to give everything away, but I am saying you and I have to be willing to give everything away. And that ought to make you a little bit uncomfortable because whether you recognize it or not, I'm not saying you have to write a check that empties your entire bank account, but I am saying that God will call you to give of yourself in ways that will make you uncomfortable. And if you have not been uncomfortable with the degree to which God has called you to be generous and to give, then I would say that you are not interacting and you're not being impacted by it. You're not listening. Because he's going to call you not only to give of your resources, which are his anyway. He's going to call you to give of yourself. He's going to call you to give of your worship. He's going to ask you to throw up your hands when you're a reserved person. He's going to ask you to lift your voice sometimes and declare his glory when you can't see it with your physical eyes. Because the essence of faith is that I am trusting and believing that which I have not yet seen manifest, but I know that he's true and that he's faithful and that he'll do what he said he would do. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Yeah. Good things happen, we said last week, on the way to church, on the way to worship. Notice the importance that the temple played. Notice that as they enter into the temple, there is this man who is there at the gate called Beautiful. And one of the points we made last week was that when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, there is an expectancy, there is a longing, there is a willingness and a readiness on your part to notice the opportunity that God brings about. Peter and John didn't miss this guy on this given day because they had been filled with the power of the Spirit. They saw things they could not see before. And can I say again to you, not just about generosity and giving, but our ability to see the things God wants us to see requires us to yield ourselves and say, yes, Lord, I want to see what you've got going. I want to collaborate with the work that you're involved with. This man is not named in Scripture, and I made the point last week that there's no name given to this lame man because in reality, though he was lame and had not walked, all of us could find ourselves in that situation. All of us are the man. All of us are the person who is in need of the power of God to flow our way and to transform and change us. That man had become accustomed to his life. He had been accustomed to his routine. I said it this way, he had become accustomed to the disability. And I told you last week that oftentimes we become accustomed to the things that have bound us up and wrapped us up that we can't envision a future that does not involve chains. Are you with me this morning? You can't envision it or you can't imagine it. But listen, one of the things that the Holy Spirit will do is give you a creative imagination where you begin to recognize and believe for things that you didn't even know existed before. Some of you grew up in such hard situations and the battle for your mind has been so real and tangible throughout your entire life. The idea of having peace in your mind and being able to lay down and rest is a foreign concept to you. But I want to tell you that this morning, as His Holy Spirit moves in this place, that He will give you the creative imagination to imagine it can be so, and then to believe for it. Because He longs to do it. He longs to give it. He had become accustomed, but Peter and John were introducing him to something that he himself, he says, silver and gold will fix me for today. Silver and gold will make it better right now. But Peter and John recognized not only were they not sent to give silver and gold in that moment, they were sent to give something much more real and much more eternal than that. He had friends that brought him to the gate. They laid him there, and we talked at length about that, the irony that he was laid at the gate called Beautiful. Imagine the irony of laying, unable to walk, and every day of your life you are disabled, you are broken, you are recognizing your own dependency on everybody else, and yet as you sit there, you are in the shadow of a gate called Beautiful. The irony of that to me is just so amazing. It's so astounding. But it reminds you that God out of the ashes can bring beauty. It's the same theme I mentioned a moment ago, that some of us can't envision a life any different than what we currently have. And true transformation and change begins by being willing to allow God to give you a different vision for the future. All right, so that was review. 4.5 minute review. You were here last week now. If you weren't here, you're here. They were full of the Holy Ghost. And I want to tell you this, over and over and over throughout the book of Acts, we see them being filled afresh and anew with the Holy Spirit. Somebody would sit back and say, how many times you got to be filled, Pastor? They just was filled a day ago. They got full last Sunday. They got full the last time the people got together. Listen, the desire of God is that we become so filled that we are like a bucket that is topped off, that every time you go to move, it just sloshes out and it makes a mess everywhere. Except the difference is that the sloshing bucket and the power of God flowing out of you isn't making a mess, but it's bringing life to all the dry places and all the broken places. Do you understand? A room ought to be different because you walk in it. The attitude and the atmosphere of things ought to change because you arrive not in your own authority, not through your own power, but you arrive under the authority and the banner of Jesus Christ. You are declaring life and resurrection and resuscitation. And I'm telling you, and we sang it a moment ago, everything has to come in alignment with the words of God. He spoke into the chaos. He created, He fashioned, He formed. And just like He did it there, Jesus uses His words through His ministry to speak life. Go and sin no more. Arise, take up your mat and walk. Jesus' words alert everything that is, that it has to come in alignment with the thing God's up to and doing. And I want to tell you, nothing's changed. There is a spirit of expectancy that we should receive. We should receive that spirit of expectancy, and it will allow us to see things others don't. It will challenge us to take advantage of the opportunities that God gives us. Expectancy is contagious. Can I make a comment as I pause for a moment? You came in this morning expectant. I didn't give you a survey. I'm not telling you this because I did a survey, an informal survey as you came in the door. I'm telling you this because when I stepped on that front row this morning, I could sense behind me that there was a whole lot of folk that were ready to press in and touch the garment of Jesus. I recognize that there were some folk who came in a lot of different circumstances and situations in their lives, but they were expectant. What I'm trying to tell you is that expectancy is contagious. You get hungry, you get thirsty, you get expected, and the people you bump up alongside of in your day-to-day life, they're going to say, hey, I want some of that. You ever stood beside by somebody when you're hangry? You ever been hangry and somebody beside you is eating a Snicker candy bar? There's a moment where you'd give anything to just snatch that Snicker candy bar out of their hand and eat, or maybe by chance they're going to pull another one out of their bag and offer it to you. That's the way contagiousness of expectancy is. That when you're standing alongside others that are believing God, there is a sense in which your faith is stirred. Your expectancy is stirred. We are iron sharpening iron. Notice what happens in verse 4 is that Peter and John fix their eyes on the man. They look at him. Their attention, remember, this is the temple area where there are thousands of people and people are pressing and clamoring. This is the mall on steroids.
This is the mall when it's packed right before Christmas and everybody's trying to do their late show. This is, there's people everywhere. And the Bible says in all of that, that Peter and John fixed their eyes on this one beggar. Now listen, I want to tell you, there was more than just one beggar at the gate. There were more than just a handful of folks that were right there. But in that moment, the Spirit of God pointed out to Peter and John the man, and they fixed their eyes, the Scripture says, on him. Can I tell you this? That you can't bring heaven down on what you don't see. You can't bring heaven down if you don't even recognize the need. Dear God, I'm about to get excited. You can't bring heaven down if there's no compassion in your heart. There's no expectancy in your spirit. If you can't recognize the need, I want to ask you this morning, is it hard for you to pass need and circumstances and situations? Listen, I know in our day and time, you've got to use some discernment. And I'm not saying you just make it rain to every need that you come in contact with. You don't want to enable sometimes, but I'm telling you this, that the people of God cannot become so constipated financially and spiritually and every... Did I just say constipated from the pulpit? That's another whole sermon. Spiritual constipation. It's a real thing. Look it up. But you become spiritually locked up to the point that you no longer see your role as a conduit. Listen, if he can get it through you, you've heard me say a thousand times, he can get it to you. And so the thing is, you can't bring heaven down until you've got eyes to see. So they fix their eyes on him. And God will give us those kind of eyes to see what he's up to in the need. There may be 100 folk at the gate, but that guy right there had an appointment, a destiny, a divine moment, and they had to have eyes to see him. It's our job to lock our eyes on the need, the place where God is working. And Peter says to the man, look on us. Now listen, I got to pause for just a second and say, do you understand what that statement, look on us, means? It means you are putting yourself out there. They didn't just whisper a quiet prayer as they passed him by. This makes me uncomfortable. I don't know if you're uncomfortable. I'm as uncomfortable as can be about this. Because there's something about standing to the edge of the cliff and declaring something out loud. I guarantee you if I ask you to pray about something, nobody in this room would have any problem praying quietly or silently or without other people knowing about the need. But if God spoke to us and said, I want you to walk up to that person, that man, that woman, and I want you to declare this, and I want you to believe that right there, right at that moment, I'm going to transform their life. I pray we'd do it, but I bet you we'd be challenged. I bet you we'd be challenged to stop rolling down aisle 8 at Walmart and actually launch a prayer on aisle 8 that gets a little bit disruptive. But here's the thing about it. If we want to bring heaven down, your kingdom come, your will be done in earth as it is in heaven, we've got to be willing to see it as God gives us eyesight to see it, spiritual insight, but then we've also got to be willing to step out there with Peter and John and say, hey, look on us. Now, the common tendency of the man is going to be look because he believes that money's coming his way. Why? Because that's always what happens. When he says, you know, alms for the poor, alms for the poor, and Peter and John look at him and say, look at us, he thinks he's about to get a hefty payday. He doesn't know that Peter and John are on a whole different wavelength, and they recognize that God is not just about to give some silver and gold. He is about to restore this man's life completely. There is a holy boldness. There is a confidence that God was going to do something in that moment. God, give us a holy boldness, not a recklessness, not something that we start bruising fruit when we go to pick it because we're, you know, unsympathetic and have no compassion. But God, give us faith. God, give us the willingness to step up in situations and believe that you are who you say you are and you'll do what you say you'll do. And to believe that right there on aisle 8 or right there at Sam Smith Park or right there in the parking lot of the car. You don't have the parking lot where the cars are. You don't have to ask the pastor to come join you in a prayer. Now, the pastor's happy to come do that. I'm speaking in third person, aren't I? That's just weird. I'm happy to come out there and help you. But listen, the reason I don't run all over this place and feel like I got to get up and everything is because it isn't all about me. It isn't all about the prayer I pray or the faith that I demonstrate. What I'm seeing here in this altar and among this group of people, the people of God, is a boldness and a willingness to recognize it ain't just the pastor that's supposed to pray. It isn't just the pastor that's supposed to declare it. It isn't just the pastor that's supposed to care. So why not me, Lord? Send me. And folk are running up. Listen, the most exciting thing I see in terms of revival at CFC,
One of the most exciting things I see is our willingness to run to this altar and pray for other people. You say, Pastor, that's it? Of all the things you could be excited about, 30 people on Wednesday night and all the other things that are happening, I'm most excited about that because once we start to recognize each of us are Peter and John that have been filled and should be filled with the power of the Spirit, and when we walk by the gate called Beautiful, we don't have to call in reinforcements because the reinforcement is the power of the Holy Spirit which is bubbling up inside of you. You're filling up your bucket so everywhere you move, it's sloshing and coming out. Listen, if you're smart in the natural, you don't fill a bucket up all the way because you know there's no way that you're steady enough for it not to go everywhere. But when it comes to spiritual things, fill that baby up. I can't imagine walking away from the station without receiving and being filled to an overflowing tank, would you? The reason we need overflowing buckets is so that everywhere we walk, even when we try to shut it down, because we get hard-headed and stubborn and faithless sometimes, that it still just sloshes out enough to stir up our faith and get us going again. Ah, come on now. You got to recognize that your greatest asset isn't your money, though God can use that too. Peter and John weren't interested that day in opening their wallet, though sometimes you got to open your wallet. Listen to me. But they understood in that moment that God was up to something different. The power of God was going to work through them. And they embraced the agenda of God. Silver and gold I don't have, but what I do have, I give you. Silver and gold is the thing that the man expected. But they had to help this man with more than just silver and gold. Look at verse 7. There is this faith and expectancy at work. So Peter, after telling him to fix his eyes on him, look at me, Peter takes him by the right hand and he lifts him up. You understand, the buddies of the man, the friends that we read about, they set him down. But Peter, filled with the power of the Spirit, is lifting him up. I'm going to say that again. His buddies set him down, but the power of God working through Peter and John was lifting him up. They were pulling him up. They set him there, his friends did, but Peter picked him up from right there. And the scripture says in verse 7, and I think I'll do a little dance immediately. When you reach out and you adventure yourself and you do what I'm talking about, the power of God to be brought to bear immediately is always on the table and possible. I struggle with that. I don't know if you do or not. If I'm being transparent with you this morning, I struggle with that, man. Because I'm trying to understand what God's up to. Is this going to be progressive? Is this going to happen over time? Is this going to be, how in the world do you pray? But can I tell you, we need discernment and we need wisdom and an understanding of what God's up to so that we're not praying amiss. But I'm telling you too, we need to start from the premise that this could be an immediately moment. I'm going to say it again. We need to start from the premise that this, if God sent us there and put us there and the bucket sloshing over, might be an immediately kind of moment. Because this is what the Bible says. Immediately, change began to happen. Immediately, faith was exerted. And it says, his feet and his ankle bones received strength. I love the detail. Power of God moving, the authority of Jesus being declared, the Spirit of God at work, and his feet and his ankle bones begin to be strong. The scripture says in verse 8, he jumps up. He stood and he walked into the temple. Listen, did you notice that he had always been at the gate of the temple, but he had never been able to go into the temple? The difference was at this moment with what God was doing is that he was going to places he had never been able to go before. Freedom comes and you go places you've never been able to go before. Do you understand the torment of being set by the gate every day and recognizing what has happened beyond the places you are able to get? It is torment to know that you are locked in a station, in a position, in a situation, and everybody else is experiencing what's on the other side of the veil, on the other side of the wall, on the other side of the thing, and you're stuck on the outside. But Jesus shows up through Peter and John and says, hey, you're going to go places you've never been before. Immediately, strength returns to his ankle bones and his feet, and he jumps up and he begins to run and praise God. All the people, scripture says, saw him praising God, and they knew something big had happened. Peter begins to explain this miracle in verse 12 through 26 to the people. Peter was always looking for a place to preach, wasn't he? He's like me. He had a captive audience, didn't he? Wasn't nobody leaving. They'd just seen the man get up and walk. They'd just seen the miraculous happen. But chapter 4 says this, that Peter and John are taken into custody because they're preaching the resurrection of the dead. They're preaching that Jesus was crucified but rose again. Stay with me just another minute or two because I'm going to give you something that's worth taking home, I promise you. Listen, the reason the Sadducees were so anxious to put this message, to crush it, was because, remember, the Sadducees are sad because they don't believe in the resurrection. You remember singing that song as a kid, don't you? Don't you remember that song? They're so sad, you see, the Sadducees. Okay, maybe it was just at my children's church. But the Sadducees didn't believe in resurrection, and Peter finds it emphatically important to declare Jesus, whom you crucified, has been raised again and brought to life, and it's going to get the Sadducees all stirred up. And listen, he's taken into custody, and the next day he appears not only before the Sadducees, but he appears before the scribes, the high priest, Caiaphas, all of his families. Understand, the stakes suddenly went higher. I want to tell you that if you're faithful at the gate called Beautiful, and if you step out and you declare what God is up to, the stakes are going to exponentially move up. But as the stakes move up, the presence and power of God to support you and use you in that moment will equally ratchet up. I got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Opens prison doors and sets the captives free. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Spring up, oh well. Ooh, Lord, have mercy. As the exponential ratcheting up of the situation happens, the well of life flowing out of you is equal to the task. Dear God in heaven, it is absolutely up to the challenge. You say, I'm going to back up. I'm going to stop doing it because I'm scared of what's next. I'm telling you, don't be afraid. Don't back up. Don't turn in the other direction. But know that the same God that met you at the gate called Beautiful is the same one that will meet you before all of the big wheels in town. They're asked, by what power or authority have you done this? Listen to me. The powerful will always ask that question. Who gave you permission to do that? Because they're about manipulation, and they're about control, and they're about being a bully. And they're always going to want to know, who is it that told you you could do that? Listen, I want to tell you, I believe in authority granted and given. I believe in the laying on of hands. I believe in all the different structures that are put in place for accountability. But ultimately, when the Lord puts the fire in your gut, when he sends you forth, you don't need anybody else to somehow validate that necessarily, because it's been validated and the calling is steadfast and sure from him. So I don't care where you've been or what you did or how you felt disqualified. When you're stepping out in obedience to the thing he's called you to do, then do it with all the confidence that the same power that rested on others will rest on you, equal to the task. Peter, in verse 8, filled with the Holy Spirit, amen, preaches another sermon right there in the middle of them. And then in 4:13, the leaders see the boldness of John and Peter, and they perceive, I love this, that they were highly educated and influential movers and shakers with lots of financial resource. Well, I just butchered that one up, didn't I? They looked at them and said, there's no way these untrained and uneducated men could be that smart. And they marveled and said, they have had to be with Jesus. Would to God that this revival, thank you, Danny, that we're experiencing in this place and in this time of really all over the world, would to God that it would translate in this reality, that when we walk into situations and circumstances, the thing they notice is not our degrees, and they don't notice somehow our influence bestowed by men, but they know that we've been with Jesus. There's no higher thing that somebody could say about you than that the essence of Jesus, the smell of Jesus, the mind and the heartbeat of Jesus, it beats through you and I. That's why the disciple that Jesus loved continually found himself, as they would recline and lay around in these intimate conversations, laying on the bosom of Jesus.
There is something about hearing the heartbeat of someone else. We do it sometimes when we're holding our babies and you just feel the little pulse of that heartbeat and you become connected in ways that it's unimaginable to think of. And it's the same way with us and God. When we spend time laying over on His bosom and hearing His heartbeat, when we walk into places and spaces, people will say they've been with Jesus. The leaders saw the lame man standing and they could not deny the miracle. So they did what those kind of folks do. They threatened Peter and John in verse 18. And in verse 19 to 20, and I'm almost done. This is the 2-minute warning. For those that were baptizing, this is the 2-minute warning. The leaders threatened Peter and John. And in verse 19 to 20, Peter and John say, "We must speak the things that we have seen and heard. Thank you very much, sir, but we cannot listen to your prohibition because we have been anointed and sent by the one who is greater than you." And listen, get ready. If you say things like that, you are going to have fiery darts hurled your way. That is not going to go over well with those who are powerful and influential. So in verse 21, the religious leaders threatened them more, but the scripture says they could not punish them because they were afraid of the people, and the people had embraced the apostles, and the man who had been healed was 40 years old. Now, I know I said 2-minute warning. Can I stretch it to 2 minutes and 35 seconds? Because you need to hear this. The religious leaders do what people who have religious spirits do. They threaten, and then when there is no power to do anything else, they threaten again. But they couldn't punish the men and do anything beyond rebuking and speaking harshly to them because the people were on the side of the apostles and the man was 40 years old. I got to wondering, Dave, about that 40-year thing. Now, any of you that have read the Bible in different places, you know 40 is a pretty big deal. And what I recognized and began to realize is that 40 is oftentimes considered an age of transformation in the Bible, an age where you come to, dear God, where you come to understand it. It was 40 years on the backside of Midian that Moses has turned around for 40 more years of service. 40 pops up over and over and over again. Some of you are already ahead of me now because this man at 40 years old was having a transformation. This man of 40 was having something done inside of him at a traditional age that was a place where you came to understanding in the Jewish faith. It was happening to this man. How in the world could the religious leaders speak against it? So this is what they do. They do what they do. The opponents will always try to intimidate you. They will always try to bully you. They will always try to manipulate you. They will try to twist the facts. The tactic of our enemy is that he will try to bully you when he can, intimidate you if you listen, and then he will try to twist the facts and make you believe things that are not true. It is absolutely the thing that Hasatan, the spirit of the age, the Satan, it is the thing he does. But I want to tell you, it's the same tactic that so many that oppose you will try to do. They will see if you're for real. They will push and see if you are willing to stand. They will throw a punch and see if you're willing to absorb the blow in the name of Jesus. They will test you and push you. They will twist the facts. But listen, the scripture says, after being threatened, the apostles run to their companions and they said, "Woe is us! The sky's fallen, Chicken Little. We better give this thing up." No, they didn't say that. They walked up in that space, in that place, as the people of God were gathered, no doubt praying for those who were giving account of the gospel of Jesus in another place. And they knew that there may be beatings and scourgings and potentially death because Jesus said you could expect it. And yet when they arrived back, they began to praise God for the ability and the opportunity to be tested as Jesus was tested and to suffer as Jesus suffered. I want to tell you, you want to know how spiritual you are? It's not by how many times you do this, that, or the other. How many times do you thank God for the things He allows you to go through? How many times do you thank Him for the ability to identify with the suffering of Jesus, knowing that as you identify with the suffering He has endured, that He will bring you through it? We have a high priest who's been touched with the feeling of our infirmities, who knows where we've been and what we're going through, and is talking to our Father about us and speaking on our behalf. They rejoiced. They could suffer like Christ. They prayed for boldness. They prayed for healings and signs and wonders. And notice what happened. Minute and 25 seconds. Verse 31, the building shook. Wait a second, I thought that was Acts chapter 2. No, 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 we're a couple of chapters over here, and the building is still shaking when the Spirit of God comes in. Yes, Lord. Lord, have mercy. Buildings are still shaking when the Spirit of God is moving. You understand? Edifices of men still fall in a rubble heap when the power of God moves. You tell me God can't shake this place. You tell me smoke can't fill this spot. And I tell you, you need to go back and read the book of Acts. Because when the Spirit of God shows up, the manifestation of His power, the glory with which He reveals to men, if you're willing to wade up in it as He beckons you to come, oh my gosh, hang on, you're in for the ride of your life. If you thought the scream machine when you were 7 was something, or the mind bender when you were 9, Lord have mercy, folk. The building shook. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. They spoke the word of God boldly. There was extraordinary unity among them, and they were incredibly generous. And the scripture says this in verse 33. The grace of God was upon them. The grace of God was upon them. CB, will you go ahead and come on up and grab your guitar? The grace of God was upon them. All right. As I'm waiting on the kids to come in, I'm going to enact this and kind of, you know. Shaken, power, manifestation of God. And at the end, on the other side of all of that, the grace of God is so tangible that it goes out of the building with you. Wouldn't bother me at all for them back doors to swing open and the smoke to roll up in here. Listen, because we didn't got no smoke machines here. We didn't do it. I promise you, if you start seeing sparkling lights, there might be a bulb that needs to be changed. But I promise you, we're not trying to manipulate the moment. What we're saying is that when the power and presence of God moves up, everything that needs to shake is going to shake. And the stuff that stands on the other side of the shaking is the stuff that He's put as the foundation in your life. But when you walk out of this place, do you know what my prayer as the pastor of this fellowship is? That the grace of God, the influence of God over your heart is so great and is so strong and is so powerful that what happens when you go out there is different than it happened last Monday when you went out there. God's called us to do, is it? He didn't call us to peek around the corner and see if it was safe to come out. He didn't call us somehow to see which way the wind's blowing. He didn't call us to see if the political foes out there are going to throw darts against us. He said, walk out, stand up straight, look at those to whom I reveal my insight to you, and then say, look on us, because something about to happen in you. Now, if you ain't ready for that, and if I ain't ready for that, God get us ready. You hear me? I'm not saying I'm ready. I don't even know what that means, quite frankly. But I want Him to expand my expectation. I want Him to make me bold and courageous. I want to run the second half of the race until Jesus calls me to go be with Him. I want to run it with every ounce of strength I've got. I want to burn the wheels off the car with everybody shouting, put on the brakes, put on the brakes, put on the brakes. Accelerating across the finish line. You understand, I don't know when Mamaw's going home to be with Jesus, but I promise you this, that there is a sense if we could see what's going on, and when you get as close to being with Jesus as she is, I'm talking about the veil, I believe, just thins to the point that you're not sure if you're there or here half the time. But there reaches a moment where you breathe out and God breathes back in and you are with Him. And I'm telling you, I want to have my foot on the accelerator all the way. People go to scream, put the brakes on. Put the brakes on, put the brakes on. And listen, you will burn out if you're not continually being filled with the Spirit and power of God. All right, I'm going to preach sermon number 2.
beautiful little girl that we're fixing to climb into that baptistry pool and baptize. Do you hear me? God's done claiming her as His. He's reminding you and I. He's reminding her, but He's reminding us. She's mine. Before you knew how much love you could have for one person, before you knew you could love her like that, I was already loving on her before she was ever fashioned or formed, before she was ever made in the womb. And at that age, she's climbing into the waters and asked me last week, I want you to pray that I can get well and go back to school. And then after church said, I want to be baptized. Because the power of baptism is that you are declaring to the world, you are not sneaking around the corner and seeing who's watching. You are stepping down into the water and saying everything that it means to be identified with Jesus. I want that. And it'll get you praise from some, and it'll get you fiery darts from others. When you hear the voice of Jesus as a kid, no other voice will satisfy. When you hear the voice of God and you say yes, nothing else will satisfy. You're going to hear a whole lot of voices and a whole lot of white noise, but you done heard the Master speak at an early age and it was printed up on your spirit and you said yes to Him, a prayer you've got to pray at least a million times throughout your life, but you started your young life by saying yes. And the pain and the hurt and all of the obstacles that will come her way, we're praying and we're cheering her on and we're believing that God, who brought her into the baptistry pool, who gave her wisdom and insight and the willingness to say yes to Him, I want to follow Jesus, is the same one that's going to be with her every step of the way. So this is a prayer of gratitude and thanksgiving. But it is also a celebration among the people of God that there is one more that is headed in a right direction, and we're going to pray and we're going to encourage and we're going to exhort and we're going to love on, and when the enemy tries to come against them, we're going to stand in between the enemy and them as best we can and declare, not this one, not this one, spirit of accusation, not this one, spirit of addiction, not this one. Lord, help.
this beautiful building, but it feels a little bit like Cedar Creek in here. So we're both catching our breath so that neither one of us drink 5 gallons of water. But I was thinking about the fact that so oftentimes scars are put on people's hearts and lives at very early ages. But not today. Today's the day where the mark of God is being placed over a young woman who is saying, with everything that is within me, I want to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. And that's what happened today. And there's 80 to 100 people here that are celebrating. There are those that are watching that are celebrating. But I need to remind you that all of heaven is erupting right now. All of heaven is shouting adoration and praise to the one who loved us so much that he redeems us, that he makes us whole, that he marks us as his, said, this is mine. And today, that's the declaration you're making, that you're going to follow Jesus. Your desire is to let all of these folks know that Jesus has come into your heart, as we say, and he is calling you to follow him, and you have said yes. That's everything you want to say. Okay. Father, right now, this group of people that are gathered to witness this and all of heaven that is ready to erupt, Lord, we are simply giving you gratitude and thanksgiving and praise, Lord, for what you have done. You have imprinted your presence and your power upon this young lady, upon her heart, upon her mind. And today this yes means, Lord, that the journey she has been on with you, Lord, is amplified. She has taken a step in obedience and she said, I want to follow Jesus. Father, I thank you for the work that is being done in her heart. And even as we've listened to and we've preached, it is our heart's prayer today that your Holy Spirit would fill this place, that your Holy Spirit would fill her to overflowing, and that when she leaves this place and she gets dry, Lord, the water in her bucket is going to continue to slosh everywhere because she done been filled. Father, I thank you and praise you that you long to do it, and we simply receive it now, and we thank you now. All honor and glory and praise goes to you, Father. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, there's people over there too. Just a minute, I'm gonna have you cross your arms and then you're gonna hold your nose, and I'll tell you before I take you. Ready? Go ahead and cross your arms. On the profession of her faith in Christ and her determination to follow him, I am thrilled to baptize her in the name of the Father, the Son, and may the Holy Ghost fill her to overflow. See what he'll do with us. See, but if you want to strum a little.
one another. I don't know that I've ever seen a bigger smile. I love you. See you.